Rev up your engine!
Well, here's a case of the pot calling the kettle black. GM is now suing Fiat Chrysler, saying that union bribes of Fiat Chrysler cost GM billions of dollars. Bad is going after worse. GM says that there's a pattern of racketeering by Fiat Chrysler from 2009 to 2015 that left GM paying higher wages than Fiat Chrysler, and it allowed Fiat Chrysler to use more temporary workers and lower paid secondary tier workers than GM. We're really getting into the bottom of the barrel now. It's bad enough that both GM and Fiat Chrysler are making poor vehicles, but now GM's suing Fiat Chrysler saying, hey, because of the shenanigans they did, we had to pay our workers more. Well, let me tell you, if they're whining about paying their workers too much, maybe they should worry more about the quality of the vehicles they're building rather than, oh, we want to pay our workers less, and then take Fiat Chrysler to court over this one. I doubt that the suit is going to get it anywhere. They were trying to say that Fiat's setting up a deal where they could pay their workers less and get a deal with the unions where they could use lower tier pay for newer employees, trying to keep GM from getting into the same situation. So GM in this case is using the RICO Act. If you don't know what the RICO Act means, it stands for Racketeer Influenced and Corrupt Organization Act. That's why it's called the RICO Act. So GM is suing Fiat Chrysler under the RICO Act. Well, of course, you know, RICO Act, a lot of that stuff had to do with the mafia. Well, Fiat, the mafia, who knows? It has to do with Italians here. I think GM's really stretching it here, though, you know? Trying to say that Fiat made it so they had to pay their workers at GM more. The world is upside down now. All they need now is to have cats and dogs living in harmony. E-Man Command 65 says, I got an 05 Chrysler Town and Country with a V6. The transmission is in limp mode. Tell me it's not the transmission that's shot. Okay, the transmission's not shot. Now, I don't know if that's true or not, but I'll tell you that. Okay, you want to pray that it isn't the transmission itself. Now, a lot of times it is, but they also are electronic nightmares. The transmission control relay. Find it. You can go to AutoZone any place. They can give you a printout, show you where the thing is. If you unplug the transmission control relay and plug it back in and it starts working, it was that relay. It's a known flaw in those. Now, they're horrible transmissions and they break all the time and will go into limp home because they've actually broken internally. But a lot of times, it's that stupid little relay. And like I say, places like AutoZone, they can print it out. Now, if nobody can find one at a local auto parts store, you can go to the dealer parts department and they will have one. They can print you out a little picture or they can show it on the screen. You get your camera, take a picture of it, and just try that and pray that it's just that stupid relay, because sometimes it is, and not the whole tranny going out, because if it's the whole tranny going out, 2005, it's 15 years old. It's really not worth spending that kind of money on one of those vans that's 15 years old. Lit up, SR9 says, I got an 08 Chevy Malibu V6 3.6 liter engine. I have loss of throttle control. I step on the throttle and it won't go anywhere. And it's got the codes PO120, PO123. Realize that your vehicle has electronic throttle. When you step on your gas pedal, that doesn't do anything except move a computer mouse. Then that information is sent to the computer. It looks at all everything that it sees, and it sends information to your throttle on the top of your engine, which is an electronic throttle. It has an electric motor that will open a certain amount according to what the computer says to open. You got a problem in that system. Now, unless you have all the equipment I have and a lot of experience, you're just going to be guessing. But from my experience with those, it's normally the throttle piece itself, the throttle that's on top of the engine. The throttle assembly goes bad. Sometimes the pedal sensor on the pedal goes bad too. On those, it's almost always the throttle assembly on it. Try that. If that doesn't work, change the accelerator pedal sensor that's on the accelerator. But more often, it's the one on top of the engine, the actual throttle assembly, because it's on top of the engine. It's hot in there. Gas and stuff flies through there. It's in a really horrible environment. The one that's on your accelerator pedal, that's just under the dash. Nothing happens under there. It's hot in the winter when you got the heater on. It's cooled with air conditioning in the summer. It's got a much easier life than the one under the hood. So try the throttle assembly. And I've changed a bunch of them, fixed them on those Malibus. It's kind of a design flaw. Electronics get bad from all that engine heat, and then they don't work anymore. Ben Peanut Jam 29 says, I got a 2012 Volkswagen Jetta. It won't crank, and it has intermittent no communication. Okay, Volkswagen, my favorite cars. Those things, it's a 2012, are so electronically complex. And when you lose communication, it can be any loss of communication anywhere in the system. They got modules all over the place. There is a gateway module, and that's the one that all the stuff has to pass through. And that stupid part is notorious for going bad on Volkswagens. You can't fix that yourself, because when you change that stuff, it's got to be set and programmed to work with your vehicle. You're going to have to find a Volkswagen guy on this one. And this is one of the reasons I tell people not to buy Volkswagens. Because one, you can't fix a lot of the stuff because you got to have a special Volkswagen computer. You got to be able to program it to be accepted by the other computer. When you change that little module computer, it's got to be accepted by the main one. It's a rat's nest of problems. But that's generally what goes wrong with those things. Talk to a Volkswagen mechanic, and he'll probably agree, and you might ask him what he charges to put one in and reprogram it to make it work on your car. And really, if you listen to Scotty, don't ever buy another one of those piles of junk. Tin Hearts 85 says, Scotty, I got a 2011 Jeep truck, loses throttle response, and stalls intermittently on me, but there's no codes at all. Most problems in a vehicle, though, make a car stall and hesitate if they're electronically based, or there's a fault in anything that has a sensor on it, it's going to trip a code. And it'll come up because the car's not running and the computer's going to see something's not working. But there's one exception. The computer has absolutely no idea what the fuel pressure is. So if your fuel pump is starting to fail, it can have throttle response and stall intermittently. First, change the fuel filter, because a clogged filter is just the same. If it's clogged, it can do it. Maybe the pump's fine. It's got a bad filter. Filters are cheap. Change the filter first. But if you change the filter, it's still doing it. The next thing I'd do would be pressure test it and see what the pump's putting out. If the pump's weak, then you would replace the pump. But they won't trip a code on that car when the pump's bad. That's why I'd say pump, and that's what it is 99% of the time on those when there are no codes at all. GenieGen735 says, got an old Honda Civic EX 1700cc engine. The mill lights are on and the green security light's on. It won't start. And when I hook up a scan tool, it says no communication. When you lose communication, any sensor, any wire shorting out, or any problem in the computer is going to cause that. Now, you didn't give me a whole history of the car. Let's say you were in a flood. Well, the computer's kind of low. They often get wet. So the first thing I would do would be to check the computer. I have seen those things that the windshields leak and the water leaks down, gets right in that PCM and shorts it out. The first thing, it's easy enough to get to. You take a few little plastic panels and look inside. Unplug the PCM, and if you see those connectors are all corroded, that means water got in there. Then you'd remove the computer, and if you take the computer off, it's got like, about six little screws you can take off, and then you can take the cover off. And if inside you can see it's wet and corroded, you're going to have to get a new PCM. I had to do one a few months ago, and we had the big floods in Houston that got, and then the water ruined it. But I've also seen it where rain comes through the windshield and gets it wet too. It's in kind of a stupid position. They should have positioned it somewhere else and they wouldn't have that problem. Any short in any wire or any module is going to cause no communication. But start there, because that's the thing I see most commonly on that vehicle. Christian Leap 660 says, help me, Scott, I got an 05 Honda Accord. It wouldn't charge. And I put on an alternator. It works, but the battery light keeps flashing on and off. Help! Obviously, it wasn't working before. You put an alternator on, now you say it's running. Either you got a bum alternator, or there's a problem in the wiring system. Now, from my experience with Hondas, their wiring systems are pretty tight. The Fords, the plugs often wear out, short out, Kias have problems with that. But the Hondas, they generally don't have problems with the wiring on the charging system. That alternator that you bought, take it to a place that can check it. Now, it doesn't happen in all places, but the AutoZone that's two blocks from me, you can take the alternator and you can give it to them and they can put it on their machine and tell you if it's working or not. From my experience, you got a bum alternator on that, because a lot of these aftermarket ones are cheaply remanufactured. manufactured. And if you don't get an OEM one or a brand new one, you get a rebuilt one that's rebuilt in Mexico or Taiwan or something, a lot of times they don't rebuild them all that well. So first, just pull the alternator back off, take it to a place that can test it, and odds are it's just a bad alternator. Now do check the wiring and make sure it's tight and not corroded. But Hondas don't have that kind of problem. Unless that vehicle's been wrecked, flooded, or something, the wiring on the Hondas is pretty bulletproof, and they generally don't wear out and have problems like the Fords or the Kias do. So I'm suspecting you got a bad alternator. So if you never want to miss another one of my new car repair videos, remember to ring that bell.